Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us for today's coffee chat. We are working our way into part two of the Maryland Time to Care Act, implications and strategies for employers. And with me today is my colleague Reba Letza, and she'll introduce herself in a moment to tell you a little bit about herself and her practice. You all have a lot of questions about the Time to Care Act, and so do we still. But we do have some draft regulations that we're going to cover with you today, along with some updates as well. The housekeeping notes are as usual. You would submit any Q&A that you have in the Q&A box, and we'll do our best to get to those during the presentation. We do send a PDF of the presentation to you as a thank you after today, but it's also in your resource list, so feel free to pull it down from there. And we love your feedback. We really do appreciate you taking the time to complete the surveys at the end of the webinar. So if you take a couple minutes to do that, we very much appreciate it. So the agenda today is we're going to take a few minutes, because I know you all are most interested in the Time to Care Act and where everything stands with that. But Reba's going to take a few minutes to cover current pending employment legislation in Maryland. I will say that it is a very active session. Unlike other sessions over the last, 3, 4 years, we haven't seen many employment bills pending in Maryland. There are too many to count right now, some that are quite interesting. And so Reba is going to hit a few of the more interesting ones, but there are way more than we could cover today. Just be aware of that. We'll come back in May and do a fuller update on what the results of the legislative session were. So Reba, over to you.
Thanks, Donna. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining. My name is Reba Letza, and I am a labor and employment associate in Baltimore and DC office. This has been a very interesting legislative session so far. So I'm so excited to cover some of the pending employment-related bills that could have a pretty significant impact on several businesses if they're enacted this session. So this first bill is a really interesting one, and several states, including DC, already have a similar law that's going into effect, which is the DC Cannabis Employment Protections Act. But this bill is House Bill 0525, Senate Bill 0513, Employment Discrimination Use of Cannabis Products. So what this bill would do is it would prohibit an employer from taking an adverse action against an individual because of their lawful use of cannabis products if off of the employer's premises and during non-working hours, if the employee tests positive for cannabis, or as a result of an individual's prior arrest or conviction for a nonviolent cannabis offense. But the offense cannot involve distribution to a minor, which seems obvious. So these would apply unless the employer observes that there's impairment that affects someone's ability to do their job. And of course, if an employer is conducting drug testing for employees and applicants, they would need to provide a copy of that policy in advance. So one interesting thing about this bill that kind of distinguishes it a bit from some of the other state laws that we have is that there is no carve-out in the bill for safety-sensitive positions, which is interesting. So it's interesting to see what, if any, amendments would be recommended. But if this bill is enacted, it would take effect October 1 of year. So this next bill, House Bill 0602, would expand Maryland's equal pay for equal work law. So under the current law, it's unlawful for employers to discriminate between employees based on their sex or gender identity by paying a lower rate wage to one group than to the other based on sex or gender identity if the employees work in the same establishment and they do the same type of work. So what this bill would do is it would expand those protections even further to also prevent the inequality based on sexual orientation as well. And like many of the bills that I'll be discussing today, if this takes effect, it'll go into effect October 1 of this year. So this next one is titled, this is a long title, Mandatory Meetings on Religious or Political Matters, Employee Attendance and Participation, and the short name is Protecting Workers from Captive Audience Meetings Act. So what this bill would do, it would prohibit employers from taking or threatening to take any adverse action against an employee for refusing to attend a meeting or participate in a meeting that is sponsored by the individual's employer, where the employer communicates its opinions on various religious or political matters. And an employer would also not be permitted to fail to hire an individual for refusing to participate or attend. I think that this is a really good one because several, you know, in several workplaces, there are candidates for political office that come in and speak to employees. So if this bill were to pass, I think it's really important for employers to be cognizant of that and to communicate before those meetings that the company does not endorse or support one political candidate over the other, and that participation in the event or meeting is optional. I would definitely highlight that. So if this goes into effect, it will be also October 1 of 2024. So this next one is also really interesting, and it involves one of our favorite hot topics right now, which is AI. So let's take a look at House Bill 1255, Senate Bill 957. And this one is Labor and Employment Automated Employment Decision Tools Prohibition. So this bill would prohibit an employer from using an what's called an AEDT, which stands for an Automated Employment Decision Tool, to screen applicants for employment or help decide terms and conditions of employment. So generally, it would be prohibited if it would involve a high-risk action. So the definition of high-risk action is an act that is likely to result in unlawful discrimination or have an unlawful disparate impact on an individual or group based on an actual or perceived characteristic. So this would include like race or gender. And if employers do elect to use an AEDT, they would need to provide at least 30 days notice. And like many of the bills we have discussed today, if enacted, this would take effect October 1. So this next bill relates to non-competes and conflict of interest provisions. So just as a general refresher, non-competes are not permitted in Maryland for employees who earn equal or less to 150% of the state minimum wage, which is 15 an hour. So what this bill would do is it would prevent non-compete or conflict of interest clauses for not only veterinarians, I have a dog picture on there, so not only vets and vet techs, but any individual that's licensed under the health occupations article, which can include physicians, nurses, and other technicians. So this bill would take effect a little earlier than the remainder of those in the session. If enacted, it would go into effect June 1. Okay, so this next one is another example where we see a similar law in D.C. that's going into effect in a few months. This is the Labor and Employment Equal Pay for Equal Work Wage Rate Transparency Bill. That's a mouthful. So this bill would require employers to disclose wage, benefit, and other compensation information in public or internal job postings. So currently the rule is that that information is only disclosed upon request of the applicant, but this bill would actually require a company to include that information in the job posting. So as defined in the bill, a job posting is, and I'll read you the definition, a solicitation intended to recruit applicants for a specific available position, including recruitment done by an employer or indirectly through a third party. So this would also include sites like LinkedIn or postings by third-party recruiters. So if this bill is enacted, it will also take effect October 1 of 2024. So this last bill that I'll be covering is Senate Bill 750, Labor and Employment Workers' Compensation Exceptions to Exclusivity of Liability. So to go through the general rule and recap, workers' compensation is supposed to be an exclusive or sole remedy for a worker who is injured in the scope of their employment. But this bill would actually create an exception to that and allow not only injured employees, but their beneficiaries to also file suit against an employer if the employee is injured or killed at work as a result of the deliberate intent of the employer. Now that language does sound sinister, but it's a very broad definition. So deliberate intent is automatically assumed if the employer acts in a manner that is premeditated or willful or had knowledge that an injury or death was substantially likely to occur and willfully disregarded that knowledge. So this would not only apply to intentional actions by an employer, but let's say, for example, an employee is engaged in some task that might be dangerous, such as repairing a roof, and that employee gets injured or harmed, workers' compensation might not be their sole or exclusive remedy in that situation if this bill were to go into effect. So if so, it'll take effect October 1 of 2024. So while we don't have time, unfortunately, to cover all of the interesting employment-related bills that are pending this session, I did want to, you know, include all of them in a list here on this slide. So I want to point out that there's so much more out there on these topics. We selected just a few to highlight for you today. But, you know, as you can see, there's a list of more employment-related bills pending. It has been, and Donna alluded to this earlier, but it has been quite a while since we've seen this much activity at the legislature surrounding labor and employment issues. So employers should be on the lookout and expect many more employment laws to be taking effect this year, which could require some policy and process changes. So we will stay tuned. So Donna, I'll turn things back over to you to get to the Time to Care Act.
Thanks very much, Reba. Appreciate that. Yes, more to come on the pending legislation in Maryland. And we are going to move on to the Time to Care Act. If I could get our slides to move. Harvey, for some reason, it's not moving. There we go. So we're going to take a look at the proposed or draft regulations today. Just a couple of quick updates or reminders, I should say. This actually took effect June 1 of 2022. It's been amended since that time. Now the DOL has published draft regulations. And depending on this session that we're in right now, there is a bill pending. Those draft regulations may need to change. So although these are in draft, they're not proposed, certainly. They've not been published yet in the Maryland Register for comment. And they're certainly not final. So they are still very much in draft. As it stands right now, unless some things change in the current session, the employee and employer contributions, which we'll talk about today, start on October 1, 2024. And then the paid leave would be available January 1, 2026. But that may not be the case, depending on what happens in the legislative session. And for some reason, I cannot get the slides to move, so I apologize. There is, as I said, a bill pending. It's HB0517T, and that is not yet enacted. It is walking through the legislative session right now. It's actually been through the House. It's now over to the Senate side for in the first reading, as we call it. It has to go through three readings. There may be some amendments, and then if the amendments aren't resolved between the two houses, it would go to committee. And then if everything's resolved, it'd eventually go to the governor for signature. What that would do is propose to change the contribution effective date by 6 months. So instead of contributions starting this October 1, they would be pushed off until, that's actually 9 months. I apologize, the slide should say nine. They would be pushed off by 9 months to July 1, 2025. So not this year would the payroll tax contributions begin, but maybe next year, July 1, 2025. And then if that happens with this pending House bill, the proposed change to the benefit effective date, because as you would imagine, right, the fund has to be funded by those payroll tax contributions before any benefits could be paid out of the fund. So that would be then delayed by 6 months to July 1, 2026, instead of benefit availability January 1 of 2026. There are some other proposed modifications in that bill as well, and I'm going to cover some of those today. So as I mentioned, that we do now have these draft regulations. They are that's all they are. The DOL did take a lot of time, though, to go through an informal process, had public meetings, discussed documents, did some outlines of what the regulations might be, and that has led us to the point we're at right now with these draft regulations. But again, just a reminder that a lot of this could change as not only this bill that is pending, but as the regulations are fleshed out a little bit more at the Maryland Department of Labor. So we're going to start really with the basic, who's covered, what employers. Any employer who covers an employee, who employs an employee working in Maryland is covered. You only need one or more employees working in Maryland. The size of the employer, and that comes into play when we're looking at how much payroll tax an employer has to contribute versus the employee contributing. That employer size definition is determined by anybody working for you, regardless of whether or not they work in Maryland. So wherever that employee is employed, that's going to be your total headcount for purposes of this particular law. You don't have to have a physical location in Maryland. So if you have a remote worker in Maryland, you would be covered by this law. And it doesn't require, like, unlike the DC UL, the unfair, excuse me, the DC Universal Paid Leave Act, which is a similar law. It's a insurance benefit provided through the DC government for DC workers and for employees who work a majority of their time in DC. In that circumstance in DC, you have to be able to, you have to pay into unemployment for that employee as well as pay this tax. To state that more clearly, the Maryland law does not require that you also pay your unemployment tax to Maryland to be a covered employer under this law. The only requirement is that you have one or more employees working in Maryland. That's it. Okay. And I did get some questions from last session and this one as well. Does this cover nonprofits? Yes, it covers any form of employer, regardless of whether or not you are a nonprofit. The definition of covered employee is getting more interesting, but it is an employee who has worked for 680 hours or more, and that is it. Worked for 680 hours or more in Maryland. And if we drop down to the third bullet there, those two thoughts go together. So it has to be 680 hours in Maryland. You can work it for different employers. So if I worked 100 hours for you and I worked 580 hours for my prior employer together, now I have worked my 680 hours. Those 680 hours, though, have to be worked over the four most recently completed calendar quarters for which quarterly reports have been required. Now, that's a little murky, but I'm sure if you're familiar with unemployment, the measure is four out of the five last calendar quarters, so the immediate preceding four of five last calendar quarters. That's not yet clear what this means, whether this is four most recently completed quarters that were consecutive or within a limited period of time, or just looking backwards for all time. It's four most recently completed calendar quarters to get those 680 hours. That's not quite clear. Again, there are a number of proposed changes here, and that's one of them. So they did prior say it has to be during the immediate 12-month period. Now they're saying for the most recently completed quarters. That suggests to me that it's a longer look back period to get to the 680. And the 680s have to be worked in Maryland. So if you have an employee who lives in Virginia or lives in DC and works in Maryland for you, they drive in, that person's going to be covered under this law. So it doesn't matter where the person lives, matters where they work. All right. Let's go to the next here. Okay. So there's a definition in the regulations that is pretty interesting. It's called a qualified previous employee. And a qualified previous employee is somebody who is currently unemployed. They worked for you in the past. And they're not working now. They're not connected to any employment. They're not self-employed, but who did work in a position leading to qualified employment, that 680 hours over the four most recent quarters. And so if they're not working and they're not connected to any employment, they can still apply for benefits through this new law. And what the draft regulations do tell us, because one of the questions I had when I read that was, does that mean that a person can get unemployment and family benefits at the same time? And that's not clear. So the draft regulations say an individual receiving workers' comp benefits or unemployment insurance benefits from the state may not be eligible for family benefits. So that's not clear yet what that really means, but a scenario that could arise if somebody was not available or able to apply for employment, let's say because they had a medical condition, and that would actually strike their ability to get unemployment. So you have to be available, ready to work, all those things, applying for work, all those characteristics that keep you eligible for unemployment. If you can't do that because you have a medical condition, that may be one of the circumstances here where a person would be able to get family benefits from the state, even though they're not working. So that's a little murky still. Hopefully we'll see that get fleshed out a bit in the regulations. So what are the payroll tax contributions? We mentioned that the date may be pushed out to start those contributions to July 1, 2025, depending on this pending House bill as it moves through the current session. You and your employees will contribute. If you have 15 or more employees, again, counted by wherever those employees are, not just those in Maryland, it is a 50-50 split. It's going to be a 0.9% payroll tax, and that is on covered wages up to the Social Security cap. And the proposed modification in this pending bill says the total rate will be set by the DOL by February 1, 2025. Now, what I think that means is they are going to start us with the 0.9% of covered wages, and that there will be a maximum amount of 1.2% of covered wages. But the first percentage that will go into effect is 0.9% at the beginning of those contributions. But the DOL may be able to change that every February as the bill goes on. So they will have some authority to change that payroll tax rate. And it looks like the cap would be 1.2%, though, of covered wages up to the Social Security cap. If you have 15 or fewer employees, you do not have to pay any payroll tax. You have to collect 0.45%, half of the 0.9% from your employees, and submit that to the state. But you are not required to contribute if you have fewer than 15. Again, total headcount for where all your people are working. As I mentioned, rate subject to change, and you can elect to pay all or a portion of the employee's part of the tax if you wish to do that. Okay, so this also gets pretty interesting because we've had some questions on this around remote workers. So there is a definition in the regulations, qualified employment. So qualified employment means that the employment has to be performed in Maryland. We know that, the 680 hours, but it again gets a little tricky because the regulations say employment performed partially in Maryland could be qualified employment in these circumstances. If the employment that is performed out of Maryland is incidental to the employment that's performed in Maryland, including any temporary or what they call transitory employment or isolated transactions, then that is going to stand as qualified employment in Maryland. What might that look like? Well, we are close to DC and Virginia. So let's say you have an employee that's working primarily in Maryland, but maybe they go to DC a week a month to go be at another site or do what they're doing at a job site. That might be incidental employment to their employment in Maryland, which would then qualify them for the benefits. I'm hoping they've, again, give us more guidance on this because it is a little murky. Another way you can get qualified employment is that the employment that is performed in Maryland is not incidental to employment performed outside of Maryland. It's another way to get there. And the third way is the employment is performed by an individual who's a resident of the state, and they're not working it part of that employment in a state where their direction and control comes from. So if I'm a resident of Maryland and maybe my employer's in Virginia and they're not directing or controlling me out of Virginia, then maybe I'm going to qualify for qualified employment in Maryland. This is all about remote workers, as you might guess. So we are hoping this is going to get a little cleaner as we move forward. All right. Not that that was clear, so I apologize that it is a little murky still. What is the amount of leave? I think you all are pretty familiar with this. You can take, an employee can take up to paid leave of 12 weeks. If the reason is for the employee's own serious health condition, they have a need for birth, adoption, or foster leave under this particular act, then they can take 24 weeks within an application year. And an application year is the 12-month period that starts on the first day of the calendar week in which they file an application for benefits. So it's basically a 12-month period from the date the application starts. And as you probably know already, it can be taken on a continuous or intermittent or reduced leave schedule, similar to how the FMLA works. And speaking of that, it's going to run concurrently with federal FMLA, provided the employee is also FMLA eligible. And for those of you who are FMLA covered, you know that that's very different eligibility than this law. Think of this law, this Time to Care Act or family benefits, it just moves with you. It's not attached to any particular employer. But when you hire someone for federal FMLA eligibility, they have to have worked for you for at least 12 months. And they need to have worked 1,250 hours prior to the start of their leave on a 12-month look back. So they need a year of service, 1,250 hours in the past 12 months. And there's one other third eligibility that's not important at the moment under the FMLA, but very, very different look, right? So the employee might be eligible for Time to Care Act benefits, but not federal FMLA. But if they are, you would run them concurrently. All right. Reasons for leave. So there are three buckets of reasons for leave. We have family leave, medical leave, and qualified exigency leave. Family leave is all the things you might think of, which you're also going to find under the federal FMLA, to care for or bond with a child during the first year of the child's birth, during the process of adoption, foster, kin care, kinship care, all of those things, to bond with that child after the first year of placement, to care for a family member with a serious health condition, or to care for a service member with a serious health condition, who is the covered individual's next of kin. All of these words that I'm saying have definitions in the regulations, the draft regulations. And I didn't bring all of that into the presentation today because it certainly would have been a lot to cover. Medical leave is leave taken because an employee has a serious health condition that results in that employee being unable to perform the essential functions of their job. And qualified exigency, if you're familiar with FMLA, that is under that law as well. It's to attend a qualifying exigency arising out of the employee member's, family member's deployment to active duty. So three buckets for reasons for leave. Just a quick note, we covered this last time, but the point here is that the family member definition is far more expansive than federal FMLA if you're a covered employer there, or maybe you're a covered employer in a different state and you have your own mini FMLA in that state, going to be different in this circumstance. It's very broad. So you can see it's grandparents, grandchildren, siblings, Those particular categories are not found under the FMLA. So it's much more broad and very similar to the DC definition under the Universal Paid Leave Act, their similar law. A serious health condition, whether it's family or employee, it requires, could be one that requires inpatient care, or it's a continuing treatment regime by a licensed healthcare provider, or it involves like a donation, whether that's a body part, organ, tissue, et cetera. That would also fall under serious health condition under the Time to Care Act. And the leave benefits, we're going to talk about the private plan option in a minute, but if you don't take that option, you won't have to figure out what the benefits are. The state is going to do that. The weekly benefit, it's a weekly benefit that's going to be based on the state average weekly wage. And depending on your income, depending on what the state weekly wage is at the time the benefit is accessed, an employee could get 90% of the state average weekly wage, but they might get a smaller percentage if they have a higher income. But those things you would not have to do if you go with the state-driven plan versus a private plan that we'll talk about in a minute. The initial benefit is $50 a week. The maximum benefit is $1,000. That's going to change over time. And in fact, if you are a DC employer, you know that those benefits in DC were increased probably about a year ago now, if I'm remembering that correctly. But they were increased because they had excess money in the fund. So I found that interesting too, but they had a lot of excess money in the fund and it went from 8 weeks to 12 weeks under the DC law about a year ago. So those things could change over time depending on the funding and what is available in the plan. All right, now wages, because remember you're gonna take a percentage of wages. So one of the things that you're going to have to know is what wages count as wages under this law. So what is showing on the screen is what the regulations, the draft regulations say. But on that House bill I talked about earlier, there is a pending modification that could occur. So what the draft regulations say now is that wages is just about everything. So commissions, compensatory pay, holiday pay, hourly wages, salary, of course, paid leave, severance pay, you name it, it's in there. So pretty much any form of wage. And what is not wages, as is stated in these draft regulations right now, are things such as retirement benefits, sort of sickness and disability payments under workers' comp. If you have a cafeteria plan, and you know those payments are not wages because it's tax deferred, so you're not paying taxes on those. So there's a number of different things that would not be included as wages. One of those is sickness or accident disability, and that might be your STD plan. So if you have an STD plan and an employee is getting payment from that plan, it appears that that's not going to count as wages under this particular law. But as I mentioned, that House bill is proposing to use the definition of wages as it is in the unemployment statute. So all of this might be wiped out, and then we might be referring back to our unemployment statute for the definition of wages under that statute. But it's similar. The definition is very similar under the unemployment statute. I think they're just trying to connect up as much as they can to make it simpler. So there are not multiple definitions running around. So we'll have to wait for the bill, see how that happens in session before we know what that's going to look like. There is wage reporting requirements, as you might guess, because the state's going to need to know that, and hours reporting requirements. You're going to, similar to unemployment, and you'll do this through a portal that doesn't exist yet, but you're going to have to remit quarterly the contribution rate times the person's total wages, whatever that definition ends up being, up to the Social Security wage base paid to each employee that is performing that qualified employment. We remember that definition. And you'll have to do that. Also quarterly information and hours reports. So you'll have to include wages, hours worked for each employee performing that qualified employment for each week in the immediately preceding calendar quarter. And then that report is going to be due on the last day of the month immediately following the close of the calendar quarter. So if it's, you know, January, February, March, your report's going to be due last day of April. So that's the way the reporting will go into the state, so they know how many hours the person has accumulated to get to the 680, all the good stuff they need to make those calculations of benefits. Failure to timely submit those reports and the contributions would result, excuse me, the contributions only, not the reporting, but the failure to submit the contributions would result in interest and penalties. It's a big one. The penalty is in an amount not to exceed 2 times the contributions that weren't remitted. So we probably don't want to be late when this whole thing starts up, because that would get expensive. And if you are late, then you're going to be subject to audit along with the penalties, and that would last a year after you fail to submit. They wouldn't have the ability to investigate and determine your future compliance. Okay. Leave is job protected, just like the FMLA, and there are some quirks to that. An employer can terminate during a paid leave period for cause. That is not defined in the act. It's also unspoken in the draft regulations. Nothing in the draft regulations about that. So we don't really know what that means yet. And hopefully we'll get a better idea what cause means for purposes of this particular act. Different rules do apply under the federal FMLA, as you know, because you can't terminate for cause under the federal FMLA. So if they're FMLA protected and it's running concurrently with this, there are different rules there that you would have to be aware of that you would need to comply with before you made that decision. Health benefits are protected during the leave. Yep, you have to continue whatever they had as if they weren't on leave. And just like FMLA, I'm assuming we'll get some guidance on, you know, copay, like if the employee has a contribution amount, what if there are any specific rules on that or timing on that the employee has to comply with in order to stay in your plan. But as you know, under the federal FMLA, that benefit is there also for employees if they're covered and if you're covered. Employees do have to give you notice obligations. We're supposed to get, once this thing starts rolling, notices from the DOL, a standard notice that you can use. You have to provide the notice within 5 business days of when an employee requests paid leave or when you know of it. So that's really similar to the FMLA, right? The employee doesn't have to say, I need FMLA leave. They can come and say, oh, my grandmother's sick and I need to take some time off. And that would be enough under the Time to Care Act because grandmothers are covered and that grandmother might have a serious health condition. You're also gonna have to provide notice at the time of hire, and also annually, you're gonna have to provide employees with a notice of rights. And again, we're supposed to get templates for all of these as this thing continues to roll out. If the employee has a need for leave, they have some rules to follow too. Foreseeable leave, employers can require at least 30 days written notice of a need for foreseeable leave. I would recommend that, you know, that's a policy you apply so that you know in advance if somebody's gonna be leaving your premises or leaving employment. Unforeseeable leave, they have to give notice as soon as is practicable, and that is the same under the FMLA. But this is where it gets really important. If you have a call-in procedure or you have, you know, a requirement that an employee has to notify you before the start of the day, whatever it may be, that becomes really important here in the circumstance of unforeseeable leave. One, because you need to know they're out. But two, you want to make sure that you're complying with the law so that they you're not using that time against them because this is job protected leave under the Maryland Time to Care Act, same as under the FMLA job protected leave. So you'll want to make sure you're tracking those things correctly, as well as getting the employees to notify you that it's unforeseeable. And for intermittent leave, employees are required to make a reasonable effort, whatever that may mean, to schedule leave so that it doesn't unduly disrupt your operation. And the leave increments cannot be less than 4 hours under the Time to Care Act, unless the shift of that day is less than 4 hours. And just like the FMLA, you cannot reduce the total amount of leave available by more than the amount of intermittent leave. And what that means is, if I only need 2 hours of Time to Care Act leave, you can't count 8 hours against me. You're only going to count, you know, what is actually taken by that particular employee. All right. So retaliation, of course, is in the law. And yes, you can't discharge, demote, do any of those things. If an employee files for benefits, if they applied for and received benefits, if they took paid leave under the act, if they asked about their rights and responsibilities under the act, if they told you of their intent to file a claim, a complaint, or a benefit appeal, because employees will have the right to appeal a benefit denial if their benefits are denied, or testified or intends to testify or assists in a proceeding related to the act. So if somebody complained that you weren't compliant with the act and there was an investigation by the state about that and they participated, that would also be protected activity for which you could not retaliate against the employee. So now here's the fun part that we did get a lot of questions on from the last session. Can we get out of this in any given way? The answer is no, but you will be able to apply to the DOL. And actually they're calling it, I keep saying Maryland DOL, but if you look at the regulations, they're calling themselves the Family Division, F-A-M-L-I Division. So it appears that they're just like there's an unemployment division at the at the Maryland Department of Labor. There's a wage and hour division. There's going to be a family division that is being set up to enforce and do all the administrative things they need to do around this family benefit. So you can apply for what they're calling an EPIP. We're going to look at that in detail. If your plan is approved, the only thing that I have figured out that you're exempt from is the payroll tax contribution. Everything else has to comply with the law. So you would be running your own plan. You would be adjudicating the claims if you were doing it self-insured basis or with a TPA or with a commercially approved plan. The only thing you don't have to do is actually pay the state the tax. But everything else has to look alike, smell alike, same rights, benefits, obligations, all of those things. And you can deduct to cover the cost of a private plan from your employees, but it cannot be, now the current state of the law says, but no more than the maximum contribution amount set by the DOL. The House bill we're talking about proposes to modify that to be 50% of the contribution amount. So if you did a private plan and you wanted your employees to help pay for it, you could do 50% of whatever the established percentage is right now, and that's 0.09%. So you could get back the 0.45% of that 0.9% from your employees if you wish to do so, and you are running a private plan. All right, so what is this EPIP thing? The state is calling it an equivalent private insurance plan, an EPIP. And what that means is that it's a plan approved by the Family Division, the Maryland DOL's Family Division, and it looks like what the benefits of the act are. So they're calling it an insurance plan. It looks in which the employer purchases, do this a couple ways. You can either purchase an insurance policy from an insurance company approved to sell paid family products. There's none yet, as far as I can tell from everything I've read at the DOL. There is going to be a process by which an insurance company can apply to the state for the right to have a commercial plan to run this benefit for employers in the state. So what I've read and what I understand is that the Maryland Department of Labor Family Division is working with the Maryland Insurance Administration to come up with the process by which a commercial plan could be approved and then offered in Maryland to employers. That is not in place yet. So that's a more to come concept. So you can go that way once there's commercial plans available. Or you, as the employer, can offer a division-approved private plan, which the employer self-funds, so you're going to self-fund it, and for which you are now assuming all the financial risk associated with paying the benefits and with the administration. It's all yours. The state's not going to do that for you. Whether you decide to administer it in-house or whether you get a TPA. And some of you I know, right, you might have a short-term disability that you fund internally. You're paying the employee through payroll, but you have a TPA adjudicate the claims because you don't want to look at those claims and the medical documents and determine whether or not the employee is eligible for the STD benefit. That could be set up this way too. You could make the payments, or you could use a TPA to do that as all self-insured, where you're assuming all the risk associated with having that private plan, or you go buy one through a commercial product that'll eventually be available and approved by the state. So an EPIP administrator is either you as the employer self-administering a self-insured EPIP that has to be approved by the state if you decide to do this privately, or it's an insurance carrier like that third-party company who is acting on your behalf to provide administration and oversight of an approved EPIP. Now, I know all that was a mouthful, but the bottom line here is you are going to have a choice if you do not want to pay the payroll tax to the state by buying a commercial product once it's available or self-administering it. And I am not an employer these days. I used to be when I was in HR. But when I read all of this, I thought, I'm not sure I would want to take this on. But I think it depends on your resources, how you view the costs associated with doing this, and whether or not you do have the resources and the financial backing and resources to get it done, because you are going to have to set up funding separate from any other funding that you have on the books to make sure these funds aren't mixed. We're going to look at a little bit of that in a minute. Okay, so if you did want to do an EPIP, you would have to file an application with the state. I couldn't find anything that says to me that the state is accepting applications now. They're going to have to put together the process for that, the forms and all of that. But the way the regulations currently are reading is that you would be required to sign a declaration of intent to have an EPIP. And that would be a legally binding document, of course, talking about your intent and commitment to do this. And the effective date may change. Right now, the regulations say January 1, 2026. If it's pushed back, it would be July 1, 2026. And the application, of course, is the document that you're going to have to submit to the Family Division for approval of that EPIP, in which it's going to tell the state you want to offer a private plan where you are assuming all that financial responsibility for the benefits administration, whether you're doing it or a third-party administrator is doing it. You will be required to participate in the state plan until the policy effective date for your EPIP. So if, let's say, things start up and you're paying the payroll tax and you say, wait a minute, I think I want to do an EPIP, or you're application for EPIP is still pending. Once this law goes effect, you're going to have to register with the state and you're going to have to start making contributions. That's not going to be pended while your EPIP application is pending. So once you get an approved EPIP application back from the state, that's effective on the first day of the calendar quarter following the date of approval. That's how that would work. And you're going to have to recertify your application annually for the first 3 years that you get approved. And then you'll have to do that recertification every 3 years thereafter. You're going to have a surety bond in an amount equal to at least 1 year of expected future benefits that would be paid out of the plan. There's a whole set of calculation that goes with that to qualify for the surety bond. And then you would have to maintain a separate financial account, let's call it, for any employee contributions that you collect in and from which those benefits are paid. So that is part of what we're talking about for EPIP. Continuing on the EPIP, you have to have the same coverage and leave benefits as the Act provides. You cannot go less. So we did get some questions, well, we have an STD plan now, can that just substitute in? No, I mean, most STD plans I know cover 60% or maybe 67% of an employee's pay, and it's a flat amount up to a capped weekly amount. That doesn't match what the state benefits are going to be. So again, coverage, leave benefits, eligibility, all that has to be from day one. So if your STD plan says, oh, you're not eligible for a year or you're not eligible for 90 days, that's not going to work here. Because remember, this is a true insurance benefit that travels with that employee. Any forms that you design or develop have to meet state standards, you know, for ease of use, understanding, all of that. We mentioned commercial product or self-employed. We mentioned the employee contributions. We said that you are going to be making the decisions on benefits eligibility. You're going to have to do that in writing. That's going to have to include the amount of the leave, the reason for any denial, the weekly benefit amount. And let me clarify, you could be denying leave or granting it, but you are going to have to do that in writing as required by the Act and the regulations. And you have to also give the employee a right of appeal. So if they disagree with the decision that was made for those benefits, there has to be an appeal right, just like there will be for employees under the state law. There's a whole lot more than that. This is a pretty complicated process. The application is going to have 8 elements in it. That's outlined in the draft regs. I'm not going to go over all that right now, but it's some basic stuff like contact information and whether you're going to use an insured product, commercially insured product, or you're going to do it yourself, all those types of things. It'll have information about the surety bond, all of that. If you get denied on your application, there will be an appeal process for you. And it's going to have a lot of record keeping requirements and annual reporting to the state as well. And oh, by the way, it doesn't get you out of those quarterly hours reports that we talked about earlier. You're still going to have to submit wage and hour quarterly reports to the state. You just won't have to remit those contributions because they still have to track employees' hours and so forth. Because remember, this moves with the employee. So they leave you, they go to the next employer. That's why the state is going to require you to submit those hours and wage reports to them, even if you do an EPIP. All right. More on the application process. You will have to mention you elect annually for the first 3 years. You'll have to sort of reapply. And if there are material changes to the EPIP, you're going to have to notify the DOL 60 days before any material change takes place. And the DOL has the right to deny or approve. And that would be, as you see listed there, if you're changing from one EPIP to another, maybe you're going to change from one commercial product to another, for example. You're changing the EPIP in any way to increase claims adjudications timeframes. You're doing anything that wouldn't have a material difference in what is required currently under the law. You can voluntarily terminate the EPIP if you decide to try it and then don't like it, find that it's too cumbersome, maybe too expensive, because you will be taking on the costs associated with paying for a commercial product or administering it yourself. You may even need to hire staff to do this, depending on the size of the employee base that you have. But you can terminate it voluntarily, but you can't terminate if it's within 1 year. So you'd have to wait at least a year before you could terminate. If you figure out, you know, in the first 6 months, I really don't want to do this, you're going to have to notify the DOL in writing 30 days advance of termination, give notice to your employees and so forth. And the state has the right to terminate your EPIP if you do decide to do it. And that is if you are not paying benefits correctly or timely. They would issue a notice of termination, they would also require a notice to the employees, and there would be some penalties and other things involved. If you decide to take on EPIP and then don't get it right, the state can then involuntarily terminate it. Now, it gets even more complicated, I have to say, because there are two interesting definitions under the statute, and this relates to benefit integration. So regardless of whether you do a commercial product, you go with what the state's going to do and let them adjudicate the claims and you pay the tax, or you do it in a self-insured plan and you're handling it all, there are going to be rules as to how your current benefits that you provide, paid benefits, integrate with the family leave benefits. So there's two definitions in play here. One is alternative family purpose leave, AFPL. And that means employer provided leave, leave that you are giving the employee, that is a separate bank of time off for like medical leave or family leave or a qualifying exigency leave kind of situation. And you can, with written notice to your employees, require them to use any alternative family purpose leave, AFPL, concurrently or to supplement family benefits. But that AFPL leave cannot be the type of leave that's accrued. It can't be subject to repayment if the employee leaves you. It can't be available for other general purposes. And it has to be available without a requirement to exhaust other employer benefit leave, paid leave first. That might be, I know some employers I work with have a bonding or parental leave benefit where they might pay 6 or 8 weeks of bonding leave for the parent. And that is not accrued, that it's just time available to them if they need it. That I think is what they mean here by alternative family purpose leave. And if I'm understanding this correctly, you could require your employees to use it concurrently with or to supplement the family benefits. And that is the AFPL, different from the general purpose leave. That is employer provided leave, like your vacation time, PTO, sick leave. That is not the kind of leave we just talked about. It's not AFPL, and it's not leave provided to an EPIP. In this case, let's talk PTO. So general purpose leave, we'll call it PTO for a second, even though there are other forms of general purpose leave. You cannot require substitution of general purpose leave, even if the employee asks for it. So if an employee says, oh, I really want to use my PTO instead of the family benefits, that would be unlawful. But you can agree in writing to use general purpose leave to supplement the family benefits. Employees can always use sick leave under the Act without your agreement. So it's very confusing, right? If I'm just using my vacation We can agree in writing to supplement those benefits using, but you can't cause an employee to use vacation to substitute the family benefits, right? Take your vacation first, then apply for family. That would not be permitted. So I try to put this on a slide that might make a little more sense than these two definitions. So it appears to me that the effect of this AFPL definition and GPL definition relates to what you can mandate and a person exhaust before they use a family. This is where I think it plays out. You cannot require employees to exhaust paid vacation, sick leave, or other paid time off before or while receiving benefits under the Act. You can agree with your employee to use employer-provided paid time off while an employee is receiving benefits so that they get up to 100%. You're topping them off. And I realize I'm out of time, so I have about five more slides to go. So I'm going to pick up pace if y'all will be patient with me for about four more minutes. And employees may require that benefits received under the Act run concurrently and or coordinated with employers, with the employer, provided the paid time off is for parental care, family care, military leave, or under a disability policy. So more to come on that. We'll work on hopefully cleaning that up for you so that as you think about benefit integration, you can start to think about how this is going to work with your current plans. There is an extensive section of the draft regulations on claims processing that I won't spend any time on right now. The next things that you should be thinking about is we still are awaiting proposed regulations. We are still looking at that House bill to see if it's going to be passed to extend the dates by which you have to start making contributions. I suspect that it will get through the session and that the governor will sign it because the DOL probably needs more time to get this in place. You should start thinking about, as you are learning more about what a private plan is, whether that really is a true option for your business. And as the state starts to work with the Maryland Insurance Administration and we start to hear more about what is going to be an approved commercial plan, is that something you want to buy into versus, you know, doing this directly with the state and paying them the payroll tax contribution? We'll think more about benefit integration as the regulations get more finite and more finalized. But there are going to be those issues that you're going to have to address internally about your current benefits that you pay. And think about your handbooks and your policies. And obviously, this is a bit of a moving target. So please do stay tuned. If you're interested and you go on the Maryland Department of Labor's website, there is a family, F-A-M-L-I section. You can go on there. A lot of things are posted, including FAQs for employers. You can sign up to get email notices from them. Actually, I did that. It didn't work yet, but I'm probably going to sign up again to see if I get those email notifications. But there are resources for there if you have time to read through it and start familiarizing yourself a little bit more with the Act. That is it for today. I appreciate your patience as we sort of rolled over. I thank Reba for joining me today and covering a bit about the session. And we will be back in May, where we will do a deeper dive into the Maryland legislative session and also update you with what we know about the Time to Care Act. Thanks, everyone.